Good evening, everybody. Look at the cameras now. We're live. Welcome to this fireside chat, a very special fireside chat, because it is the very first fireside chat of Sam Chevalier, who has joined us from Cape Town, where everything happens extremely slowly. So it is quite nice to have him out here. It's a bit different from Brent Leo Smith, of course, who moves at 150,000 miles an hour. Sam Chevalier moves at roughly the same speed as a slowly moving glacier. This was evidenced by his performance just before his town trip today, where he was supposed to leave at 9:30 and was found to be fetching water for himself at 9:50. Oblivious as to why there should be any consternation that he was leaving late. This is not his fault. It is because he grew up in Cape Town, where things don't happen very fast at all. So, we have half an hour with you, and it's a great joy to be chatting around the fire, as it is all over Africa around this time of the day, where people sit around the fire and share stories with each other. We're going to talk about Sam and to Sam. We're also going to be talking about Karula and her little baby tiny cubs that you managed to see and I didn't.
And it was a coin flip,
actually. We'll tell you about that, too. Then we're going to talk about the excitement of Cheetah Plains, the introduction there, and, of course, the not-so-ironic thing that we saw Cheetah on the Cheetah Plains, which is marvellous. But before we do that, Brent Leo Smith, of course, is going to be hying from the lion sighting, where he is now. He will join us very shortly. While we do that, let's get a little bit of an introduction to Sam. So, Sam, a question from Kathleen in Pennsylvania. She'd like to know... That's very nice. She'd like to know what your training is, what your experience is, how did you come to be here? Tell us a little bit about how you came to be where you are, speaking with your beautifully slow Capetonian way here in the wilds of the northeastern corner of South Africa.
Thank you, Kathleen. I'll try and make this as quick as possible. We'll see how it goes. You know, it's been incredible coming through to Juma Game Reserve. My training was at Londolozi Game Reserve, which is probably about 10 to 20 miles to the south of us. And wow, it was such an incredible time where I spent a lot of time on my own in terms of walking those roads. And I had to understand the roads and also to see what it was like to be in the wild on my own. And I also did a number of trainings with some of the head rangers there. So that was my main training. But other than that, I did a lot of my own training, which is to understand the world that I live in, to understand the ecology that surrounds us. And I went from Londolozi to the Cedarburg Mountains just north of Cape Town. Incredible, incredible wilderness that is so different, but so uniquely beautiful in its own way. From the black eagle to the beautiful Cape leopard and the caracal, which is exceptionally difficult and rare to see over there. So here, the abundance of the savannah is incredible, and it's such a privilege to be around Jamie and James and Brent, because they've had a lot of experience here. And, you know, I'm really thrilled, and I was nervous taking on this task, Kathleen. I was quite scared. But to have presenters and other people that are on the team that are so richly experienced, I feel very privileged to be immersed in that kind of space. So, yeah, I hope that answers a little bit of your question. And
absolutely.
I think it does. And I think, I mean, I don't know, what did you want to say something?
I was just going to say, I'm so emotional. But this was spoken not in our favour again tonight.
I just also wanted to say that it's a great privilege to have Sam here, because he doesn't come from exactly the same background that Brent and Jamie and I do. And, I mean, your last experience was your master's, which was done in biomimicry. We're not going to get into that now. He's going to teach you that over the course of the next probably 10 years. You might get to the bottom of it after a decade or so of Sam presenting. It's actually making me cry as well.
Just learning all
of that. Anyway, so Sam's going on a journey of discovery here, and he brings with him a wealth of interesting ecological knowledge, sort of big picture Gaia knowledge, which I think is just a real joy to have around here. Get out of the way, Jamie, sit down. Thank you so much. Okay, let's move on from Sam on to Karula, and I'm going to hand over to Jamie here to introduce you to what you're about to see.
Well, we've had the most extraordinary time that we've spent with Karula, and Brent initially on the Sunrise Safari and then myself on the Sunset Safari. And I have to be honest, I didn't think we were going to see them on the Sunset Safari, and it was as I was pulling out of the sighting, I knew that they were there, and I didn't want to spend too long with other guides wanting to come and have a look. But I was just as I was pulling out, she started contact calling Right, I think that the lovely ladies in Final Control have a clip prepared for you, so let's have a look.
Guys, Karula's brought her cubs to Juma. We've been tracking her. Look at the little guy. We just came around the corner. We're just going to keep very still. Isn't this amazing? Look. Here they come. Oh, my goodness. Isn't this exciting? This is incredible. You can hear all the birds, alarm calling at them. Oh, look at that. It's so cute.
Number two is a little bit more shy, but there you go, they can climb the trees. They can climb trees. It's okay, little one. Little one. Hi. Hey, how gorgeous. It's okay. Now, I have to say that was one of the most extraordinary sightings I have ever experienced, and I think it's the anticipation as well. It's been that build-up, that 2 months of knowing that Karula has cubs somewhere and just waiting for her to bring them across and to show them to us. And it really was to watch that little... They sound like frogs. It's incredible. I mean, I totally went into... I don't think I talked about one fact. I don't think I spoke about anything that was of any interest. I just cooed. It was very girly. It was quite embarrassing. Yes, I cooed.
It was pink.
I cooed.
It was pink. Okay. Jamie didn't, in fact, find them initially. That was initially Brent Leo Smith, who is going to join us now.
Hello.
Hello, Brent. Why don't you walk in front of the lens?
I know. It was dark out
well
there.
Done.
Hello, everyone.
Yes.
And so you put me on the short side in the smoking.
Yes,
again.
Correct. Oh. And so, Brent, you found them in the morning. Tell us about your immediate emotion when you first spotted them.
Panic. Absolute panic. Trying to get Final Control to crash cuts. Fiddling for radios. It was so exciting. So what happened is we'd found her tracks earlier. We heard the tracks on quarantine, which we thought might have been her, so we jumped ahead thinking she had gone quite far, and it turned out those were male tracks. So we left them, and I said to Jean, let's go just go back and check. And then as I looked down at the ground, I saw a track... set of tracks going back, and I was like, oh dear, she's coming, she's gone already. And we drove around a blind corner. Smoke.
Yes.
We drove around a blind corner, and literally there they were in the road 5 meters from us. It was incredibly exciting. And wah.
Yeah.
Wah.
Wah. Okay, wah. That's the emotion. You cooed.
I cooed. You went wah. Says wah.
Now then, you went back later on with Mr. Chevalier here, and Sam, you saw a leopard cub on foot.
Yes.
How did that feel?
Yes. So it was incredible. So it was the first time I've ever seen a leopard cub on foot. So young, I've never actually seen a leopard cub on foot or in a vehicle, let me just say that. It was incredible. Brent woke me up, he was like, we're going for a walk to see if we can find them. We got in the vehicle. We were going, and I was like, okay, so where are we going to go and where are we going to stop? We got out the vehicle. We walked for about 50 meters, and then poof, there was Karula. And Karula went off to the side, and the two cubs just got up and they looked at us. I just wanted to stay there, but the Brent had to pull me back.
Because, it's not a good idea to stay with the leopard cub and her mother.
No.
Normally results in some fairly terrifying growling.
Yeah. But it was an incredible experience to be able to look at those cubs, and my heart just went, I don't know, ba-bang.
Ba-bang. Okay, so we've got cooing, we've got wah, and we've got ba-bang. And Wicked Ange, you say that you were very terrified, of course, for those cubs, because for a long time we didn't know if they had survived. And I know that there are a few amongst our number who shall remain nameless, who will probably not put their hands up, who said, there we go, well done, you brave people, who said that Karula's cubs had expired, that they had gone off before to their time. And I just had a feeling, which was based on nothing other than a simple feeling that perhaps they were alive, and what a joy it is. Yeah. And we now have them, a little bit unjoyful that she's spending quite so much time south of us with them. And so we hope that she does bring them forward, or north, to spend a bit more time with us here on Juma. Right, let us move on from Karula. We have a packed show, as I said to you earlier. And from Karula, we went to Cheetah Plains yesterday, and I think you've been there, I've been there, you have yet to go there. The only reason Jamie was at the Leopard and I was at the Cheetah Plains yesterday was we flicked a coin to see who would go to the Leopard Cubs and who would go to Cheetah Plains. I don't think either of us really minded which way we go, because being at Cheetah Plains was such an enormous privilege and excitement. Have a look at our first drive. From the giant plains of Cheetah Plains, 550 hectares here in the southern northern Sabi Sands. Here is the boundary of the Kruger National Park. This is so exciting. And you can even see where the fence used to go. So this is it, everybody. Across there is the Kruger National Park. Running away there is a jackal, everybody. And that is a, look at its white tip. It's a side-striped jackal. Wonderful to see it in the middle of the day, and it's no coincidence that we're here in a clearing and the jackal is there. There's a black-backed jackal. And there's a pair of them, and that's what you'd expect. You'd expect a pair of them to be in a clearing like this. Two species of jackal in one.
So there you go, everybody. That is a little taste of the new reserve that we've been having a look at. 550 hectares, a very nice little safari lodge there. And some of the characters from there, of course, that we've been meeting over the years. Ephraim, with his slightly nasal tones on the radio. Lovely man that he is. He's a tremendously friendly fellow, and it's lovely to be in closer proximity and operating with him. And, of course, just Craig has recently left, and he has been replaced by Mike, who we've been seeing quite a lot of. And, of course, the head ranger there is Andrew. We've been seeing him. I think, is it a 12-bed or 20-bed lodge? Okay. We don't know how many beds it is. I think it's a 20-bed lodge, something like that. Oh, whoops. And they obviously traverse a huge number of areas, so if you ever want to come out here and you ever stay there, it really is a very good spot to stay, because you traverse Torchwood and Biffles Hook and Vuyatela, where we sit now, and indeed onto Arethusa. So lots going on there.
And you might get to see our ugly mugs.
Yes, you might get to see our ugly mugs.
Now, that first drive that you went on, as the tears stream from my face, James, you saw the two different species of jackal, am I correct? Now, Heidi, watching in Switzerland, she would like to know a little bit more about jackal's habitat, what they feed on, and how many cubs they have, how many pups they have, sorry.
Yes, the answer is no cubs, of course.
No cubs.
let me take over from you. So, Heidi, two jackal species, and unusual to find them in the same place. I mean, that really doesn't happen very often. The side-striped, much more solitary. The black-backed, we saw them, and not surprisingly, they live far more in pairs. And I guess the most obvious difference between their diet would be the black-backed has a far more meat diet. It's a much more of a carnivore. They are both quite omnivorous, but a black-backed is a renowned scavenger and hunter of small mammals, whereas the side-striped, well, probably eats quite a lot more fruit. Mm-hmm. And that's where the jackalberry gets its name from, actually, from jackals eating the fruit of the jackalberry. And they will also eat probably smaller things. They'll probably eat a few more berries and that sort of thing than do the black-backed jackal. Then pups. They do have pups, and normally born in little burrows under the ground, and they're not so much in termite mounds. I mean, it's often sort of subterranean, which is quite interesting. So probably also termite mounds, but not the Macrotermes fungus-growing termites, probably an Odontotermes mound that's been excavated. So often subterranean, it's a different kind of termite, and that's basically where they're born. And if I'm not mistaken, anyone can correct me here, I think it's two to three pups. if yeah. I'm not mistaken. I don't think it's I've often much more than that.
Record, I saw, I've seen blackbacks with six mm. once.
Okay.
So it does happen.
Up to six.
We had three pups, four. So with the side stripes on Arethusa airstrip not so long ago.
Okay. So far fewer than a wild dog would have, and far fewer perhaps than a domestic dog, and I don't know about a wolf, but I'm assuming that a wolf would probably also have up to 12, 13, 14 pups sometimes.
As far as I know.
So I think that's how it goes there.
Talking a little bit about animal homes and where they go and burrow, of course, we've got our fantastic spotted hyena den up across on Aubrey's Road, and I went pop past there, it's a little guilty pleasure that I like to go and just spend a bit of time with them. So I took my little brother there this afternoon. It's the first time he's ever seen spotted hyenas in the wild. But Cindy wanted to know whether we have any idea about the concept, whether there are any spotted hyenas denning on the plains, and if we have any ideas where they might be. Now, I haven't been there more than a couple of times. I don't know.
I tend to think that our clan extends onto cheetah plains.
I wouldn't be surprised.
I mean, we know that our males definitely do go south into Little Gari. Whether they go that far east, I don't know.
Possibly it could be a Mala Mala clan coming up from the Sand River there. Yeah. There were quite a lot of hyena tracks. We didn't see any hyenas. But there's always a possibility there could be a den in one of those big, thick blocks on the crest.
And some of them are quite thick.
Very thick
yes. blocks. Some of them would make a chimpanzee nervous. They're so thick. Anyway, so it's unlikely that there's a den. I'm pretty sure that the rangers there, who are very experienced, would know that if there was a den there. So as Brent says, if that is a separate clan territory, it's highly likely that the clan is based probably south on Mala Mala. So it's just to give you an idea, Cheetah Plains is south of us. I mean, you've seen us driving along the what we call the Gari Main Road, which is that southern boundary, fairly main road. And all the way to the properties to the south of that, we don't traverse. And obviously, we've got to go quite a long way east before we then turn south onto Cheetah Plains. So it isn't actually conjoined to Vuyatela. So, yeah, it's all a voyage of a discovery for us. We don't exactly know what's going on there. But I'm sure if we see a hyena that is local to us, all of our hyena resident experts, Chris Rogue and Shell in Detroit, you will definitely be able to identify them and you'll be able to tell us if they are from our own clan, or perhaps we'll start a whole new adventure of discovery with the new hyenas of the area.
So exciting.
That is very exciting indeed. Now, of course, Cheetah Plains, Brent, is known for?
Cheetah!
Yes, well done.
Thank you.
Would you like to take us through your sighting today?
It was a little bit challenging. It was quite far, but it was really great that we actually got to see some cheetah on the Cheetah Plains. And they actually passed right through the middle of Cheetah Plains, past three in a row pan, and they were found in Coral late this evening. But unfortunately, we weren't able to find them again, but we saw them this morning, and I won't lie, as much as a lot of you know, I love tracking things and following footprints. This morning, I tracked a car. I saw the car on the other side of the boundary suddenly go from sort of do-do-do-do-do-do-do, boop-boop, and start burning dust down the boundary. So I said to Brian, no, let's go have a look where he's going, because you don't go at that speed if there's nothing there. And we were lucky enough to actually get a view of those two male cheetah atop a termite mound.
Right, have a look at the clip.
Cheetah! Cheetah! Cheetah on Cheetah Plains!
Oh, look at that! Look how streamlined and sleek it is, built for speed. Oh, they're up and on the move, both of them. What have they spotted? Congratulations to Liz in Wisconsin, her first cheetah sighting. Yay! High five. There we go. The killer bees are back. Cheetah, lions, you know, that's how we roll. So, wasn't that wonderful? So those are the same two male cheetah we have seen occasionally on Juma, but they tend to keep towards those more open areas on the eastern side on the Kruger boundary. And it is wonderful and open there, hence the name Plains. So really, really great. Initially, we thought it was gabbro, but obviously we hadn't spent much time down there. And now we're pretty sure it's sodic site, so not gabbro, but very, very productive areas of short grass and herbs. So although we haven't, Mr. Wildebeest, actually we saw one wildebeest on the plains today. Although we haven't seen a lot of sort of the grazing species, those large herds of buffalo and wildebeest and zebra will move through that area, especially as it gets more dry.
And also perhaps some mechanical clearing that's been on. I mean, we do know that lots of Sabi sands has been mechanically cleared, and that's not a bad thing necessarily, because obviously, you know, it has thickened over the years, so it's entirely possible that there was some mechanical clearing, correct?
Yeah, it looks quite old.
So exactly.
Probably 70s, late 70s, when there was a lot of that clearing going on.
Would you be able to explain quickly what mechanical clearing is?
Well, mechanical clearing is the clearing of bush using means other than elephants. So either by hand or with a bulldozer. And so, I mean, there are large sections of the Sabi sands that have been cleared like that. And look, we could go into long debates about whether you should or you shouldn't, but the simple fact of the matter is that we don't know what this area looked like. Go into long debates. So either the justification for it is always, well, we're trying to make it as natural as it was before. No one knows what it was before, and so we manage according to the animals that we want to see, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. Andreen, a question from you about how we prepared for knowing our way around Cheetah Plains, and I'm going to ask Jamie how many hours a day she spent studying the map of
Cheetah
Plains.
Endless hours, James. Hours and hours. Mm-hmm. I just sat at my bedtime reading was the Cheetah Plains map. Honestly, it's the journey of discovery. That, I think, is the most exciting thing. And you'll find that with all guides. That's half the fun, is going there, getting lost. I think it might be quite difficult. I haven't been to Cheetah Plains properly. I don't know how easy it is to
get lost.
I made
a brief visit to Chitwa Chitwa by mistake yesterday.
Okay.
I nearly went to Annette's this morning.
So, yes. I mean, the only thing I did was basically to just look through a few of the leopards that I think we can see there in Kanyeni and Tandi and brush up on what their spot patterns are. That's pretty much all I did. A little bit of research, of course, into my memory banks of Gabbro Plains, but that, of course, has been shelved again because there aren't any Gabbro Plains.
We'll have to wait till we extend our travels even more.
Yes, exactly, to the Gabbro Plains of Torchwood, perhaps. They definitely have got Gabbro Plains there. Sam, are you looking forward to going to Cheetah Plains?
I am thoroughly looking forward to going to Cheetah Plains. Well, I was actually there just yesterday or 2 days ago. I had to go and help some of the guys that were setting up the mast to protect them from any wildlife that came around them.
To protect them?
Well, yes.
Did you protect them thoroughly? That is excellent news.
These are the two fellows who put up the mast and ate most of the food. Our food budget will never be the same.
But they did a great job because we don't seem to have any sort of signal breakup at all. And just to give you an idea, I mean, it's not a question of just organising a traversing agreement and then driving onto the land. I mean, I took you to, those of you watching yesterday, I took you to that mast. I mean, it's quite a production. It took I think the concrete plinths were put in probably 3 weeks before to dry. Then these guys came out and erected this 21-metre pole. And, I mean, some of you watched it happen and filmed it for Jerry's 52-part series on this Cheetah Plains mast erection. Watch out for it on a channel nearby. And she's going to kill me later. But, Brent, you filmed a lot of it, and it was really impressive the way they pulled that thing up.
It was, so they brought it through in pieces, and each piece weighs 70 or 80 kilograms.
Okay.
And there were about
pieces. That's about 200 pounds each.
No, about 9 pieces. They assembled them on site, and then basically got a funny little... Hello, hyena.
Hyena's heading, Brandy's talking rubbish.
This really funny little pole that they stand there, and the funniest thing was, once it was amazing watching the guy once he's up. I mean, he's balancing. He just locks his feet in. It was raining and windy, and he starts undoing things. Just, like, balancing 20 metres in the air, starts fiddling around, but it was really incredible. The actual erection process took about 5 minutes once they got it on the winch.
Yeah.
But it was incredible.
And then they put you?
No, I was just going to say, it was actually fascinating to watch that whole process of going up. And we had to leave afterwards with all those guys to come back. And
after you'd protected them.
Well, protected them. Sat underneath the mast and just looked out for elephants, pretty much what they did. But it was so interesting getting back down into the vehicle and then trying to drive back from Cheetah Plains, which I've only just driven into during the day in the nighttime. So I had to get through Cheetah Plains into Juma at nighttime, where I've only been here for a week, so it was quite an interesting experience, to say that.
What you're saying is you may have gone via Lion Sand.
No, I don't know actually how we did it, but next thing we were in the research camp, so we We did it somehow.
Yeah. Now, question on that note from Kitty Kitty Bang Bang, the greatest name on Twitter. You'd like to know what would happen if we do cross the boundary. Well, mercifully, in my case, I haven't been caught doing it, of course. And, I mean, I guess, Brent, if they were to catch you, it depends on the level of ego, I suppose, of the individual landowner and whether you were genuinely doing it by mistake or you were trespassing.
Very different things.
Yeah, and I think, by and large, the people we know around here would be completely understanding about it.
And we've all done it. You get lost. It happens.
Some more than others. me.
Yes, James.
Sorry about that. Anyway, so that's Cheetah Plains, everyone, and it is a joy for us to be there, and it's a joy to us to share the discovery with you. I think that we love Juma, we love Arethusa, but it's a wonderful experience to be able to go on to a new piece of land, especially, of course, as the eastern boundary is on the Kruger National Park. Now, I'm going to play you a wee song, and this little song is tinged with sadness. I've sung it before, and I've sung it before, I think, at a similar occasion. Of course, we have young and old watching all the time, and our oldest viewer today, I think, was 92. Well done to you, Betsy, sending your first email to us. Great stuff. Please keep sending them, Betsy. It's wonderful to have you with us. And then we have our much younger viewers. And we lose viewers every so often, old and unfortunately, well, it's always unfortunate, but especially unfortunately, youngsters. And yesterday we heard that Matty, who was just 9, died of cancer, unfortunately, and he died on Thursday. And I'm going to sing a little Zulu song called The Crossing, which is about the crossing that the Zulu people believe you make to the land of your ancestors when you die. And it's just to send Matty on his way, and we hope that wherever he is in the universe and the ether, whatever your belief might be, that as he makes his crossing, he will remember us fondly and watch us from wherever he is. So, Matty, this one's for you, and we'll see you all tomorrow at 6 o'clock as the dawn breaks over the wonderful African wilderness that we call home. Bye-bye. Remains with me here, clear as the light of day. Oh, see, is I, oh, see, is I, sis, oh, figa, we, baba, no, ma. Oh, see, is I, oh, see, is I, see, a good la, lum, shaba, see, a wela, la, peshe. Takes a beating without making a sound. Through swollen eyes, he sways and he smiles, 'cause no one can put him down. Inside him, a boy looks up to his father for a sign or an approving eye. Oh, it's funny how those ones so close and now gone still so affect our lives. Oh, see, yeah.